The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. We're coming to you today from Iowa, Des Moines, Iowa. I'm currently working on a project for Hulu where we're trailing the candidates. It's been an absolutely mind-blowing experience, and I'll talk about the show that I'm working on in about 2 weeks before it premieres. This has just been one of the highlights of my sad, pathetic life. We've been in Myrtle Beach at a Tea Party rally. I got to see Donald Trump speak and Mike Huckabee and Ted Cruz, and then we were off to New Hampshire, and I got to see all the candidates. And now we're in Iowa where it's freezing cold, and I'm in a food desert. If you want to know why America is fat, come to Iowa, the pork capital of America. I'm a vegetarian. I try to be vegan. Traveling throughout Iowa, forget the fact that you cannot get opaque coffee. I will say this about Starbucks. I finally had some Starbucks, but you cannot find opaque coffee. And by opaque coffee, I mean coffee should not be translucent. You should not be able to see through your coffee when it's poured into your cup. I have not been able to get a good cup of coffee here in Iowa. I understand that. People are calm in Iowa. They're beautiful people. They're nice. They don't need to be agitated the way I do. I need caffeine. I need mud. Whatever you think of Starbucks, God bless Starbucks. I finally found a Starbucks in Des Moines, Iowa, and I had a dark Italian roast. There was a New York Times inside the Starbucks. I know I sound like an annoying New York elitist snob, but I don't ask for much in life. I just want muddy coffee to wake myself up. I understand if you live in Iowa, you don't need to be as awake as I do. I understand that. Beautiful people, Iowa, kindest, goodest people in the world. The goodest people in the world are in Iowa. And I've learned hanging out with the Cruz supporters and the Trump supporters is what Obama has been saying all along. And that is, there's not that much that really divides us. There really isn't. We're all on the same page. It is in the best interest of the parties and the media to find wedge issues. I think we're all on the same page when it comes to abortion. I think most Americans aren't thrilled about abortion. I think we can work together to figure out a way to have fewer abortions in this country. But instead, there's a lot of money to be made by political advisors and the media to get us worked up and to hate each other. I'm very passionate about gun control. I think if we're going to fight a ridiculous war in this country, we fought a ridiculous war against drugs. I think if we're going to fight a ridiculous war, we should fight a war on guns. I think what's going on in Oregon should pretty much explain to the NRA supporters that we cannot defend ourselves against the government. No matter how many arms you stockpile, the government will win. And that is why it's important to teach civics in our high schools, in our elementary schools. And instead of taking arms against the government, be part of the government. Vote, caucus, get involved. You don't need guns to take on the government. Become part of the government. If more people got involved with the government and studied the issues, we wouldn't be as divided. We're all on the same page. I understand why people are behind the Second Amendment. They feel threatened. Well, change the media. Educate people. They wouldn't feel so threatened. All these issues can be solved without anger, without hating one another. Although, when people, especially at the Trump rallies, talk about somebody uniting the country, well, I get very frightened. I don't want the country united. I think it's healthy to have discourse, to have arguments. We don't want a united nation. That's dangerous. Nazi Germany showed us that. But if we're going to be divided, let's have a conversation, an exchange of ideas, instead of just screaming about the other side and having these ridiculous Thanksgiving dinners that have now become our political debates. I mean, we really are seeing, I'm talking about the Republicans, we're basically seeing a bunch of crazy uncles, except for Kasich, getting up and just spewing nonsense. So that's why I hope Trump gets the nomination. The Republican Party deserves him. There should be a crack up in the Republican Party. He embodies everything Republicans have been trained to believe these past 30 some odd years. He is the fruits of what the Republicans have spewed. There's nothing he's saying that Republicans don't believe in. In the past, they used dog whistles. Now, Trump is just saying it. He says everything Republicans believe. So I hope he gets the nomination right now. Right now, I hope he gets the nomination because the Republican Party deserves it. The question is, in November, does America deserve him? I don't think so. I think we haven't gotten to that point. So I'm optimistic about Trump. I hope he gets the nomination. I've seen him speak three times. It's remarkable because he does not discuss policy. He talks about himself. He talks about the polls. He does impersonations of the other candidates. He does put down humor. It's like watching Don Rickles, and he really knows how to talk in front of thousands of people, which most comedians and performers don't understand. Bing Crosby taught us how to communicate with a microphone, and Trump understands this. You don't need to shout. You have the amplifier. So he gets up there and he whispers in front of thousands of people, and he brings you in, and you get intimate with him, and you start feeling, not me, but a lot of these people who feel disenfranchised, they come to these rallies, and because he's whispering and telling you about the process, the political process, you feel like an insider. You feel he's telling you things that only he knows and only you're hearing. He's the best communicator we've had since Reagan. Smarter than Reagan, but has no policy. No policy whatsoever. And he is supported by every horrible human being on the planet. Sheriff Joe Arpaio yesterday appeared at the rally in Iowa where I was. The most horrible human being on the planet. An actual fascist. This is the guy who makes his Arizona, he makes his prisoners wear pink underwear, spies on the DA in Arizona to threaten him, going after Mexicans. This is a bad guy, Sheriff Joe Arpaio. He endorses Trump. Jerry Falwell's son, an evangelical, has now supported Trump. The evangelicals are getting behind Trump, thrice married New Yorker, who used to be for abortion. The evangelicals are behind Trump. It is exposing who the evangelical leadership really is. They're just about money and keeping their business going. Anyway, Trump, no substance. And the media, well, after seeing three Trump rallies, I wish I had the money, the organization, to cover Washington and to cover politics the way it needs to be covered. I was down in Myrtle Beach, the Tea Party rally, and I saw Trump speaking to the Tea Partiers. And he said that Obama won't bomb the oil wells of ISIS. And he said, believe you me, when I'm elected president, we will bomb the oil wells of ISIS. And he said, can you imagine if we had a general like Patton or MacArthur who was told not to bomb the oil wells of ISIS? Do you think they would obey that order? No, because they're real patriots and they love America. And the Tea Partiers started cheering. He said, we need more generals who know what's right and who will disobey an order from their commander-in-chief. Well, there was the press covering this. And I'm listening and I'm thinking, everybody talks about how Truman-esque Trump is. Trump likes Truman. Truman fired MacArthur. because MacArthur disobeyed Truman's orders in Korea. Here you have a man running for president. Many people liken him to a fascist. Here he is in front of the Tea Party celebrating generals disobeying Obama's orders. And I'm walking out. I'm wearing my Trump stickers for reasons I'll discuss later. I'm going in as a Trump supporter. And the press walks up to me and they say, "So what do you think? What do you think about Trump going after Cruz and attacking him personally?" Because they thought I was a Trump supporter. And I asked ABC, Reuters, I don't remember, it was a local newspaper. They all three of them walked up to me thinking I was a Tea Partier. And they all three wanted to know what I thought of Trump attacking Cruz. And I asked all three of the reporters, "Did you just hear Donald Trump talk about how great MacArthur was and Patton was because they would disobey the orders of their commander-in-chief?" All three of them discounted that. One or two of them didn't even remember that. And they all said, "That's not why we're here. We're covering the race." And I said, "Well, why aren't you covering what these men are saying? We're not paying attention, you know, on those rare occasions when Trump offers up a glimpse of what he plans to do or what he believes in. You should report that." And they're not interested. The press is not interested. They're getting orders from high on up to cover nothing but the horse race. Well, elections are about policy, not the horse race, not about who's going to win and who's going to lose. The thing about Mein Kampf is all you had to do was read Mein Kampf to know it was time to leave Germany in 1933. Hitler pretty much said what he wanted to do. And it is the role of the media to report what these candidates not only believe in, but what they want to do once they get into office. When you turn on the news, I'll leave a rally, then go watch how it's covered, and nobody is talking about the solutions offered up by Trump, as few as those solutions are. I mean, he's really just giving you an insider's look at what it's like to run for president. That's what he does. He's short on substance. He's just going to surround himself with huge geniuses who will solve all our problems. Again, the Republican Party deserves this because the only candidate who does not insult the intelligence of the American people, as I can tell from going to these rallies, is Kasich, Governor Kasich of Ohio. He's the only policy wonk running. Jeb Bush is an effing liar. He's a disgrace. Trump has done a tremendous service to this country by just crapping on Jeb Bush and putting the Bush name where it belongs in the garbage. That being said, I went to a Jeb Bush rally, a town hall meeting in Keene, New Hampshire, at a country club. I get the Bush family. You know, this is in New Hampshire. It's beautiful. If I grew up as a Connecticut Yankee and my family could be traced back as far back as the Bush family can, and they're sentimental people. They cry all the time. They love America. They love their America, but they genuinely believe that they were here first, and it is their responsibility to protect this country from change. They're not against change. They just want to slow it down. As William F. Buckley said, you know, stand athwart history and say, slow it down a little. I get that. If I were from New England and I had money and sitting in that country club, which was not extravagant, very puritanical, not gaudy, I understand why people get behind the Bush family, but not after George W. became president. Now, their name should be synonymous with failure. Okay, I think I covered everything that I wanted to talk about. I will talk about more once I get home and I have time to review my notes. It's been an incredible, incredible experience these past 3 weeks traveling with the candidates. I'm not going to talk about Bernie and Hillary because Obviously, I want Bernie Sanders. That's a whole other issue. Maybe I want Bernie, maybe I don't. I just feel Hillary is a safe bet in a pretty unsafe electoral cycle. I mean, if they nominate Trump, I just want Hillary. I don't want a socialist running against Trump. I love this country too much to actually see Trump get elected. I just want Trump nominated. So I'd like it to be Bernie. I'd like it to be Hillary versus Trump. That being said, listen, I played it safe with Obama. I wanted Hillary and Edwards before Obama. I just didn't think America deserved Obama. I thought after 8 years of George W. Bush, we didn't deserve to feel good by electing somebody like Obama. I was wrong. I mean, Obama is, I think, the greatest president of the 21st and 20th century, with maybe the exception of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. This guy has been tremendous. I know, I'm an Obama apologist. But that being said, Hillary, Bernie, either one I'd be happy with. We're doing a benefit January 29th, 2016, from 7 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. at QED in Astoria, Queens. We're doing a benefit for Bernie Sanders. We're calling it Keeping Hillary Honest, a benefit for Bernie Sanders at QED in Astoria. The idea is, look, we want to give Bernie money because we believe in everything he's saying. The longer he stays in the race, the more Hillary is going to have to move to the left to shore up the progressive base. So let's give Bernie money, and that's what we're trying to do. Even if you're a Hillary supporter, you should come out and support our benefit at QED. Here's the lineup. John Fugelsang from Sirius XM's Tell Me Everything. Frank Conniff from Mystery Science Theater. Trayvon Free from The Daily Show. And it's hosted by Liam McEnany from Tell Your Friends. You know him from this show. I am not going to be there. I was originally going to be there, but this project that I'm working on has gotten extended, so I can't fly back to do this benefit. But it doesn't matter. This is about raising money for Bernie Sanders and John Fugelsang and Frank Conniff and Trayvon Free, and there'll be somebody filling in for me who I guarantee you is a lot more fun to watch. I think Bonnie McFarlane was supposed to be at this benefit. I'm not sure if she's going to show up. But definitely John Fugelsang will be there. Definitely Frank Conniff. Definitely Trayvon Free from The Daily Show. And definitely my good buddy, Liam McEnany. Go to QED, January 29th, 2016, at 7 p.m., Keeping Hillary Honest, a benefit for Bernie Sanders. QED, God's Gift to Comedy in Astoria, Queens, New York. Go support Bernie. Go support QED. It's a good benefit, and it's a great show. All right, before we get to my conversation with my best friend, Will Durst, who I have known since I started doing comedy, remember to please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. Give us a good review on iTunes. There's some kind of algorithm that works. I don't understand how it works, but if you give us a good review or a thumbs up on iTunes, it moves us up the charts. It's not so much how many people are downloading these podcasts, it's how many good reviews you get. That's what we've been able to suss out after about 1,000 episodes here. I think we're at 1,200 podcasts now. We just keep going. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, and you'll see an Amazon banner. We're lousy with Amazon banners. Click on that Amazon banner. You will then be taken to Amazon. Do all your Amazon shopping. There's some kind of code embedded in the URL that allows us to receive 6 to 7% of everything you buy. It doesn't cost you extra. Remember, if you shop on Amazon via my website, it does not cost you any more money. And it helps keep the lights on here at the David Feldman Show. Also, we have premium content. We are no longer selling individual pieces of premium content. We are just posting premium content on our premium content page. We are in the process of taking all 1,000 of our episodes off the server. We're just going to keep about the last 50 to 100. The most recent 50 to 100 episodes will be available to everybody, but we just cannot afford to keep close to 1,100, 1,200 episodes on a server. It'll only be made available to our subscribers. You have to pay $5 a month to gain access to our archives. Our archives. $5 a month. Not that much. It really isn't. I just went to Starbucks and paid $5 for a cup of coffee. So, come on, $5 a month. We accept all major credit cards. Before I left New Hampshire, I talked with my buddy, Will Durst, America's greatest political satirist. Here's my conversation with Will Durst.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Yeah, that's not going to work. Okay, we had some technical difficulties bringing you the great Will Durst. Well, there's about, 15 minutes of Barry Crimmins that we took out of our last show because we had to bring the radio show in at 30 minutes. So I guess we'll run some more of Barry Crimmins, and we'll have to re-record my conversation with Will Durst. Here is the rest of my conversation with Barry Crimmins.
No, but I get to do that a lot. And I get to meet a lot of people who do a lot of courageous things. And in them, I take great strength and I have great faith. And that's what I could see. But you know, we have to choose what we do with our time. And if we spend all our time, when the last election ends, they start worrying about the next. You know, the Democrats will care about the progressive agenda just as soon as there isn't an election within the next 2 years. And there's always an election within the next 2 years.
Yes.
So what we have to do is we have to put together a large enough group of people who are informed and single-minded about real justice and about behaving decently and about not, you know, worshiping heroes and not getting into these didactic arguments with people, you know, where you just spend your whole life chuckling to yourself as you get another meme about Republicans or whatever. Maybe try to find out what you have in common with these people. I got stuff in common with the people in the Tea Party. We both know we're getting screwed. It's just somebody tricked them and put the wrong face on the monster for them. So they think their problem is some poor guy getting cheese, as the cheese is being delivered to their own home. You know?
Mm-hmm.
It's just... So go on, Dad. Go ahead, Dave.
Let's talk about comedy.
It's great in New York now. There's 35,000 people calling themselves comedians in New York right now. You know, it's like a refugee crisis. The UN should really do something about this. I think they should fly in tents, emergency tents, and set them up with microphones in them so they can get some emergency stage time to these poor people who are doing their acts 2.5 minutes at a time. Can you imagine trying to put together your set doing 2.5 minutes at a time, a real show, when you got to do an hour? You put it together, your show would look like a ransom note. Hey, what's a capital T doing at the end of this joke? So that's what I'm for. I'm for an international effort. You know, like, I'm, you know, Syria said they're willing to start taking in New York comics and people from Flint.
Well, you started the Boston comedy scene over at the Ding.
Well, I was, you know, I mean, that's an insult to Fred Allen, but yeah, I was in the modern scene. I had something to do with it. Yeah.
Yes, you did. And you can learn about that in the movie When Stand Up Stood Out.
Fran Salamita's fine movie, Call Me Lucky,
directed by Bobcat Goldthwait. It's an amazing movie, and I
recently asked Barry Crimmins to tell me about the barracks. We won't even talk about that. But you've watched comedy explode. And in the words of Donald Trump, what's going on? What is... Here's my theory, and then you can respond to it.
Okay.
When I started, I had nothing to lose. I was desperate. I couldn't meet women. I was a complete abject loser. There was no way I could make any money doing
it. I said I had to turn several years of being a screw-up into research.
Yeah.
So just hand me that microphone, and I talk my way out of the corner. Yeah.
So this explosion of comics does not reflect a need for comedy. It reflects a desperation among the populace to get love and attention that they can't get anywhere else. It's a reflection of our economy and our hateful, abusive society that so many people want to be.
It's like, the show business is full of people seeking external approval. And when you're seeking external approval to ridiculous ends, there's a good possibility that you don't like yourself very much.
So that doesn't mean that...
Well, I mean, here's the thing, David. When you and I got into comedy, you were kind of an iconoclast. You're doing what? And now it's like, it's a college course. You can study it and go into it and be this measured person with, like, sort of a crafty plan, and you can have connections that, you get to move ahead of other people. I mean, look at the... If you want to be... I mean, who the hell can afford to be an intern in Manhattan for The Onion or Comedy Central but some rich kid who
can
afford to go live in New York for a few years, work ridiculous hours, and not be paid anything?
Right.
You know, it's only for rich people.
Right.
I mean, once in a while they pick a few people out so they look diverse, but for the most part, it's just rich people. And it's not an iconoclast idea. It's like kind of a lemmings thing. So the problem is that there's still iconoclasts in there, but they're buried, They're trying to do something, but getting noticed or getting anywhere when there's, 80% of the people maybe are just joiners. It's kind of a tough thing. And then what the problem is, you and I were part of making it look, good comics make it look easy. And so they see this, that looks easy, and so they try it. And it's not easy. It's easy to be a hack. And you know what? You can have a few good years as a kid as a hack if you'll end up on some shows. Because they always like to have shiny, bright, young faces telling, crumbling, wretched old jokes. But the thing is, very few people will last. Unfortunately, they'll be thrown away, and along the way they won't have learned how to say much or to be part of much that's relevant. So even though it seems like the harder path to do the kind of things we've done, when you get to our age, you get a little more of a chance to remain somewhat relevant, because we've practiced noticing what goes on a little bit past, like, hey, I hate this TV show.
Comedy has changed from when we started, and I think it's going to survive because of this. The younger comics now are individualizing stand-up by telling stories about their lives. Yes, it's narcissistic. It's not necessarily political or anti-corporate, but each comic is unique because they're telling stories that only they experienced. So,
well, I don't know. I give them a tip of the hat. About the corn in their feces, but go on. There's some great young comics. That's who I'm trying to speak up for, the ones who really deserve it. But I mean, honest to God, if you can be talked into not doing it, it would be great if you wouldn't do it, because there's just too many people now.
Is it New York or everywhere?
It's a crisis level in New York, but
it is.
It's a crisis level.
For God's sakes,
why can't David Feldman walk out and do a half an hour any place he walks into? You're a luminary. You're a great comic, a brilliant, long time, wonderful, genius of hilarity. I mean, just so dry and funny and acerbic, and but that's it's the, you know, there should always be stage time for somebody like you, but there's just there's this stage time crisis. And the thing is, I can't just, what you have to do is to get the people really, if some of these people really love comedy, they should really think about if they belong in it or not. Because David, you know, you meet a lot of these people, you talk to them for half an hour, they don't have one witty thing to say. It's just like, and you're just sort of thinking, where did you get the idea to be a comedian?
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
We got disconnected.
And where they got the idea was they saw it on television, or they saw it on the internet. And they said, hey, I can do that. And you know what? A lot of what they see, they can do. They can take the same, you know, moldy. I don't know this thing you're saying about, you know, maybe talking about themselves, but I just don't know how interesting it is. I don't know how interesting you are by the time you're 21 or 22 years old, but I want to, but then again, I'm not, you know, I'm not the target audience, but I just don't find it that fascinating to hear, you know, if you're really funny, sure, your life is really funny, but if you're not, it's not going to save you, or your unique story about what, which college you went to, or, you know, who the bully was in high school or what, maybe, I don't know. But I just think, I mean, when we did it, even though it's daunting in a different way now, when we started doing it, it was quite daunting because there was, like, nowhere to do it or whatever, and you really had to be almost crazy to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's sort of like, well, maybe you have to be crazy enough, because, I mean, it's also such a huge, you know, the potential payoff is, you know, millions of times more worth more than what the payoff was when we got into it.
Well, I think
so. I just wish that the people who really do kind of have a vocation had a better chance to be seen and heard. And you know, there's just a lot. But
you know what? You know what I realized just listening to you, when we were starting out, the insult was, when we were bombing, don't quit your day job.
Right.
Today's
they've never had one.
That's right. They never had a day job. And that's,
although a lot of these kids do. I mean, that's not true, but yeah.
They either don't have a day job, they're trust fund babies, or
yeah,
the economy is so bad, they have nothing
what's
to
the
lose.
Difference?
The same way, what's the difference? So I do think, I love the, it's a crisis. I'm actually starting to feel.
No, it's like the UN has got to step in and start getting some tents in. I mean, if there were enough stage time, but I mean, you know, if there were enough stage time, then you're going to have an audience crisis. Because, like, everybody in this New York City would have to go to a show every night for there to be a quorum for all the comics there are to perform. You know, when I started doing comedy, I don't know, maybe there were 100 comics in the United States, maybe 500, I don't know, certainly not more than 500. And that's counting every, you know, like comic actor.
It's, you know? We're amusing ourselves to death, as the book says. There's, somebody said, in order to watch all the original programming that Netflix, Amazon, and Hulu are providing, you would have to spend 20 hours a day for a month binge-watching one whole season of Hulu, Amazon, and Netflix original programming.
Yeah.
I mean, it's... Anyway, this is always a treat. Barry Crimmins is...
Hey, David.
Yes,
and,
sir.
And, you know, I hope that the young comics out there listening to me understand, you know, I wish them well, and I don't mean to disparage them. I just said if they can't be talked out of it, they should, because, you know, if they do, they're making way for somebody, may a little slightly better chance for someone who might be better at it than them. That's all.
Well, I just want to say that when I was starting,
I mean, you know, it's like, you know what's happened in comedy? It's like if everybody got to say they were a baseball player. You know. Well, you're a baseball player, but, you know.
But that's
can't hit a fastball.
Well, I think
you
that...
You turn your head when a ball's hit at you.
I think,
you
know, that bodes well for the future of stand-up because of Little League. Little League gives you...
Yeah,
the,
we're turning stand-up into T-ball.
But people who play Little League and T-ball understand how difficult it is to catch a line drive in the major leagues.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
So I think everybody trying stand-up...
Well, in T-ball, they understand. I mean,
well, not in T-ball, but what I'm saying is that by everybody trying stand-up, you gain a keener appreciation of how hard it is to be good at it, so it builds up an audience for us. That's why it's good that more and more people are trying stand-up. You're saying some of them should try it and go away.
What I'm saying is they're just creating this mass. They're just making the haystack that much harder for the needles to be found in, you know, and I like the needles. I'm rooting for the needles, not the hay, you know?
For the first time
in
my life?
I wish everybody were a great comic, yeah. But they're not.
For the first time in my life, I actually feel sorry for New York comedy club owners.
Why? Because they have to deal with this refugee crisis.
Yeah.
I'll tell you that Rebecca at the Creek and Cave is a hero.
She's the best.
She's running a refugee center, though,
yeah,
over there.
She really is. And by the way, when you were performing there before Thanksgiving,
I was there last week, too.
Yeah, all the younger comics just poured in to watch you and were marveling at you.
Uh-huh. Yes. Well, I'll tell you, it's actually a lot of those kids who I'm trying to speak up for, because some of those kids are just great, and they just deserve a better chance than they're getting.
Mm-hmm.
And in the past, I would say, well, just go out and hustle some stage time. You know, hustle a room, do this and that. Everybody, I mean, you know, with 35,000 people covering a town, there's not a donut shop owner who hasn't been approached to do something. But, you know, they'll find a way. I mean, if you're creative, they will find a way. And in the long run, you know, it will, you know, we'll lose some good people because there's this other, it's like sane people make pretty good comics, too, you know,
mm-hmm.
and they might get out of it. They might get out of it. Anyway, you have a good and triumphant tour of...
New Hampshire.
Yeah, New Hampshire.
Yes. I'm wagging
when you're in this interview, what?
I'm wagging my tail with excitement.
Oh, good. And I'll be up there. I'll be in Manchester on the night before the primary. And
where are you going to be performing?
Hold on, I got to look it up. It's a club in Manchester, and I'll be at a bookstore / club in Portsmouth, tentatively. On Thursday the 4th, hold on a second. I'm just looking this up for you right now, David. I just cut this deal today. So let's see. Hold on. Yeah, I'm going to be at the Shaskeen, Shaskeen Pub, 909 Elm Street, Manchester, New Hampshire. At 7 p.m. on February 8th, and then I'm going to be at and then on February 4th, to do it in the wrong order, I'm going to be at the Portsmouth Booking Bar on February 4th to do a show there, and that's at 8 p.m. So Portsmouth, New Hampshire, Book and Bar at 8 p.m. Thursday, February 4th, and then on Monday, the night before the primary, at 7 p.m., I'm at the Shaskeen Pub. And if you follow me at Crimmins on Twitter, yeah, we'll have the details on how you can get tickets and stuff, or Barry Crimmins on Facebook, or I'll get it up on my website tomorrow, barrycrimmins.com.
Barry Crimmins is the author of Never Shake Hands with a War Criminal. He is the subject of a fascinating documentary called Call Me Lucky, entitled Call Me Lucky, directed by Bobcat Goldthwait. Screen it on Netflix. Buy it on Amazon. Barry Crimmins, I love you. Come back real soon.
Feldo, you are the absolute greatest, and I really enjoyed getting to work with you towards the end of last year, and let's do it a lot this year, because you, anyone who doesn't go out to see you do stand-up, it's their own fault.
The same thing, if you're in New Hampshire, go see Barry Crimmins.
Oh, and I think I'm also, can I mention one more?
Yes.
I'm at the, it's in New Brunswick, famous place, New Jersey. February 9th, actually.
The Stress Factory.
Mm-hmm.
But when
tentatively.
When are you at the Stress Factory?
I think February 9th. It's not, you know, by the time this runs, it'll probably be official. But if not, just watch. But I'm going to be there.
And then
down in North Carolina, at the end of the month of February, in Charlotte and in Wilmington.
To the Rutgers.
That's it. I'll see everybody everywhere. And I hope that among them are you, my friend, because you're the greatest. And I love you, brother.
Baby, you're the greatest.
That's right. To the moon.
To the moon.
So hang this thing up and then call me so you can tell me it was okay.
Okay. Bye.
Because I'm needy. I'm a comic. Bye.
Bye.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
That's our show. Thanks for listening. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. What else? $5 a month, you can gain access to all our premium content and our archives. Give us a good review on iTunes. Did I cover everything? Yes. From the Showbiz Studios in Des Moines, Iowa, I'm David Feldman. That'll do it for us.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps. This is the David Feldman Radio Network.